Welcome to HCAM News. Tom Nappy at the anchor desk to keep you up to date with everything you need to know about Hopkinton. The Hopkinton Senior Center hosted Dean College English professor Jeffrey Skillings. The professor and baseball enthusiast teaches a baseball-related English course and recently gave locals some terrific baseball-related facts and readings.
The sports, John Updike, for instance, with his great essay that came out a couple of days after Ted Williams' last game at Fenway, in which he hit a home run. That essay was called, it was on, I think it was in the Globe or the Herald, but it was called "The Kid Bids Adieu to the Hub." The Kid, one of Williams' nicknames, you know?
What I wanted to give the sort of merge baseball together with America's history and look at them as one and the same. That the visions and the ideals that America has had since its inception is very much a part of the visions and the ideals of baseball. That there are reasons why baseball, which is not our most popular sport, but there are reasons why it's seen as the national pastime. See, it doesn't even say sport, it says the national pastime. So it ties in with just the rhythms and the beauty of the American experience.
The distance from each base to the next one is 90 feet. Everything is built upon the mystical number 3, a beginning, middle, and end. 1, 2, 3, a beginning, middle, and end. A holy trinity, sanctity, holding the game to its spiritual vision. Until the introduction of the designated hitter in the American League, only in 1973, a bad change in my opinion, in order to bat, one had to also play in the field. It was only fair. Everybody wants to bat, but you know, to pay your dues, to get up to bat, you've got to go out there with your glove and do the best you can, like Frank Howard did in left field, right? Not a very pretty fielder, but boy, could he hit home runs. So the manager, Gil Hodges at the time, managing the 1967 Washington Senators, man of big hands, Gil Hodges. I got his autograph, so I saw how big they were. You know, he had to find a way to get Howard in the lineup.
Like so many American boys, you know, I was introduced to baseball in a very casual way by my father, just simply playing catch and him teaching me how to bat, you know, and you go through Little League and things like that. Like so many American boys, I certainly didn't have the talent to go any further than Little League, but I always enjoyed watching the game, following the game, looking at box scores. There was just something about the power of baseball that struck me in a way that no other sports did. So anyway, I teach a course at Dean called The Literature of Baseball, and that comes from, you know, my growing up and my following the game, and again, seeing something really unique in the design of the game, the rules of the game, the fact that the game could go on forever because it doesn't have a clock, timeless quality. But I saw it as a very literary kind of sport, and I found that there were a number of excellent books, novels, poems, plays about baseball. So I thought, why not? Why not have a literature course that's focused on the national pastime, a kind of an extension of American literature? And that's where literature of baseball, it's always very popular. You know, I always get a number of students who sign up for it. Unfortunately, some of them don't know that there's extensive reading and writing involved in the course, that we're not just going to sit around and talk baseball, you know, that we, a lot of writing and reading analysis.
The wall, you know, all of that, what would have been a home run in Yankee Stadium is a long single, if Ortiz bothers to run it out, off the left field wall at Fenway. And what would have been a towering pop-up in Yankee Stadium's left field is a game-winning 3-run homer in Fenway Park in early October of 1978 off Mike Torres.
Bucky
friggin' Dent would have been a pop-out. Any other, what do they say? The wall giveth and the wall taketh away. I started this class at Dean way back then, literature of baseball, because again, there's been so many really fine literary works that have to do with baseball. I guess the most famous is Casey at the Bat, you know, going back to what, 1885 or so, you know, about town ball, fictional place named Mudville. It's probably a Massachusetts town. There's a lot of images in the poem that sort of point to, Massachusetts, some of the more rural villages of that time. There's other great books, a little bit more modern than that. Of course, there's the Roger Kahn's great classic, The Boys of Summer, about the Jackie Robinson, Pee Wee Reese, Duke Snider, Gil Hodges, Carl Ferrillo, Roy Campanella, and so many others, Clem Labine from Woonsocket, those Brooklyn Dodgers, you know. And Roger Kahn was, you know, kid from Brooklyn. His mother didn't want him to have anything to do with baseball. His father did. And eventually he got this dream job as a young man, you know, being the beat reporter for the Brooklyn Dodgers, and really experiencing the camaraderie with the players too. That was a time, you know, the late 40s, early 50s, mid 50s, when, you know, the reporters did, they hung around with the ball players, you know, and they kept a lot of things secret between the ball players. You know, if a certain ball player was meeting up with a certain woman on a certain corner in a certain faraway town, you know, road game, you know, the writers kept that secret because the ball players might know that a certain reporter is doing the same thing. So there was a real sort of male camaraderie, not necessarily honor, but a male camaraderie between them. There was a trust between so many of the ball players and the reporters. But it's a beautiful book. If you haven't read it, I recommend it. The Boys of Summer, where Kahn, you know, later in life, in the early 70s, I think it is, he travels by car all over the country to visit these guys who are now no longer the boys of summer, they're the men of autumn. And they've gone through tough times, and, you know, and they just talk about, you know, that time in Brooklyn with those kinds of ball players. They say the 1951, 1952 Brooklyn Dodgers might have been simply the best team ever assembled. So now you're thinking 1927 Yankees, of course you are. But boy, that team in 51 and 52, not only on paper, but on the field. When you think of the playoff game in 51, right? The shot heard around the world. Bobby Thompson, Ralph Branca, you know, so many others. October 3rd, 1951. That was quite a team. Quite a team, those Brooklyn Dodgers. So I've used that book. I've also used, in fact, I'm using it this semester with the students, August Wilson's play, Fences. And of course, you know, Academy Award nominated film is out right now. It came out in the end of last year, based upon the Pulitzer Prize winning play. It stars Denzel Washington and Viola Davis from Central Falls, Rhode Island. And it's a beautiful play, but it's based on the life of a black ball player who played in the old Negro Leagues. Of course, it's fiction. He played in the old Negro Leagues, and he was too old. He was too old, and his skills were tarnished by the time, you know, the Jackie Robinson years came around, where the integration was done as an experiment. I would call it an experiment in American civics life, you know, bringing up these talented ball players one by one. But there was a whole, you know, there were thousands of them in the history of the Negro Leagues that never got that chance. And so the lead character in this play is based on Josh Gibson. Josh Gibson, who people call the Black Babe Ruth. And black ball players said, no, Ruth was the white Josh Gibson. This guy was unbelievable, Josh Gibson, but he was too old. A lot of them were just too old. You know, and the last one to be brought up from the Negro Leagues in 1951, I think that was the year, that was Hank Aaron, who in my mind still holds the lifetime career record for
home runs. All the others are a bunch of cheaters. And Aaron did it the right way. It's just, it's such a remarkable American story, you know, because so much of America is based, some historians have said America is based on race and space. That's been our story. It's been a tragic story, it's been a beautiful story. But race and space, the race part is obvious. The space is simply the vastness, the incredible vastness of the Republic, the largeness of the land, the rivers, the valleys, the mountains, you know, from sea to shining sea, as the song tells us. That's the story of America, you know, and with that, how fitting it becomes that the last of the Negro League players to come up as the others faded away, you know, is the guy who breaks Babe Ruth's record. And I don't mean to point it out as black against white. There's too much of that these days, and white against black. But it just seems fitting as part of the American dream that something like that should happen, that the first ball player who does break Ruth's record does it the right way. At that point, he was never a designated hitter, which I don't like at all. I don't like the DH. You know, but he was a black man who played in the black leagues, and you know, the torch was passed to Hank Aaron with that. And to me, he's got the record for all time, you know. But some other books I've used Bernard Malamud's classic, The Natural, out of which a good movie was made, a very good movie. But the movie is quite different in many ways. It has the nice Hollywood ending, and the novel does not. The novel's ending is more like Death of a Salesman. It's a little bit bleak in its comment on the national pastime, and so many others that I've used down through the years. So look, this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to get the slideshow going in just a minute. Okay, she's not here now, I don't think. Okay, Amy, I thought would be here. I got to run up to that and turn it on. And the slideshow is just going to keep running. There's about 150 some slides. There's about a 7-second pause between them. I'm not commenting on them. I won't even know which ones are going on. And they're not synchronized with my narrative. I'm not that savvy with technology to do that. It isn't my style. But I'm going to go to this narrative, something I've written, and I am going to be reading it, I hope, in an effective way. Hope it's not monotone. You know, I'll be reading it, I'll be pausing at times for asides, for other comments. And what it's going to sound like to you, it's going to sound like an American history lesson, because I am going to point to our nation's history. Baseball is part of our nation's history. Baseball reflects our nation's history. If you want to know America, you know, learn up on baseball, you know, tells us everything about our history. It tells us about our people. It tells us about our hopes and aspirations. So you'll be hearing again, you've got to go way, way back to an American history class that you took at some point in your life. I'll be making references to Thomas Jefferson and to writers like James Fenimore Cooper and, you know, the Westward Ho travel of the pioneers. It'll all be in there. It's all connected. So it's not simply the history of baseball. It's more the literature of baseball, mythology of baseball. There's a certain mythology that is connected to it. And any great culture, the Greeks, the Romans, the Norse, the Native Americans, they are steeped in their own cultural mythology. And America has that too. But I think it's best found, American mythology, meaning American ideals and American virtues, are found in baseball, more so than any other sport. I look at baseball as something more than a sport. It's a way of life. It's a vision. There's no clock. There's a sense of timelessness to baseball. You know, you watched the Red Sox game last night and you had to battle against sleep, right? And sitting in the chair, and I nodded out a few times. But I love a game like that, that just keeps going deep into the night. And it was such a well-played game, you know, with the pitching back. You'll see a lot of those these days like that. You know, and some of you maybe remember the game between Warren Spahn late in his career against the young Juan Marichal. What'd that go, 16 or so innings or something? Starting pitchers were in there till the end. You're never gonna get that these days. That day is gone. But you had a young kid, Marichal, going against the old guy, Warren Spahn, who won, what, 345 games or something like that?
361.
361 and 245, right? You know, 3.09 career earned run average. Won 20 games in 13 out of his 21 seasons. You know, wounded at the Battle of the Bulge. You know, I mean, and a lot of these guys obviously served in the military. You know, and I might make a mention of some of those. We're familiar with the famous ones, you know, Williams and Musial and Pee Wee Reese on a destroyer, Warren Spahn. But there's a lot of guys who never became famous. A lot of guys from the minor leagues who served in combat in World War II, World War I too, and Korea. A lot of the players from the old Negro Leagues, you know, served in the military, served in combat. They weren't allowed to play Major League Baseball, but if they could carry a rifle, they could serve in war. See, I mean, that's the story of America. America is constantly in the great work of improving itself and not being satisfied where we are now, constantly moving forward, just like the pioneers did. Well, I'm gonna start this up again. Is Amy here? She was here. I'm gonna start it up again, and I'm gonna take it back. And then I'm gonna go to the narrative. So, you ready for the history lesson? All right, let me take it back. And that goes, right here. Right? Here we go. And there's no sound, I'm the only sound.
Huh?
And did I start it?
Yeah, right.
There it is. Yes, sir.
Nothing.
Satchel Paige,
yes.
One of the greatest,
and he made it to the major leagues.
At age 50,
yes. Satchel Paige, who had all those lessons on how you can grow old and stay young. He was a great one. He claimed to have won over 2,000 games. Now, in the Negro Leagues, they oftentimes didn't have the money or the personnel to have bookkeepers or statisticians. So he claimed that he won over 2,000. And you know something? I wouldn't doubt it. You know, now he's probably counting in exhibition games and barnstorming and things like that too, but boy. And again, the sadness, the injustice, but that's the way we work. You can't change history, you can only learn from it, right? That he and others like him didn't have the fair shot opportunity to try out for a major league team or to be seriously scouted. All right, here I go. In his book, God's Country and Mine, the French intellectual and writer Jacques Bazoum writes about his adopted country. And this is what he said. Whoever wants to know the heart and mind of America had better learn about baseball, the rules, and realities of the game. It's been over 240 years since Thomas Jefferson and the Second Continental Congress declared independence from Great Britain in the summer of 1776. After winning war against the greatest military power on earth to secure that independence as a sovereign nation, the newly organized United States debated over a Bill of Rights and a Constitution and established a republic by 1789. In the history of the world, Rome had the longest lasting and strongest republic. It lasted 1,000 years, the last 300 in decline, while most of its citizens still thought it to be thriving. still sang out their orisons and songs that Rome was the greatest power in the world. And meanwhile, the barbarians were at the gate, and Nero fiddled while Rome burned. America's republic is a short 228 years old. America is in trouble again. We're not thriving. Our present is an entanglement of division, self-interest, and narcissism. We had presidential candidates last year from both parties who were not only inarticulate and didn't write, but also had very little knowledge of our own history and the history of the world. There is the shouting from the Democrats. There is the racket from the Republicans. It was all too young. Remember this one? Marco Rubio, forever reminding us that he is the son of hard-working immigrants, in contrast to the humility and the modesty of Abraham Lincoln, who never brought up the fact that he came from poverty and hard scrabble and had no formal schooling, yet could remind his countrymen of their collective national past by writing, "Fourscore and 7 years ago, our fathers brought forth on this continent a new nation, conceived in liberty and dedicated to the proposition that all men are created equal." Abraham Lincoln, among our presidents, was our greatest writer. In fact, I teach the writing of Abraham Lincoln in an American literature survey course that I offer. He's included in literature anthologies, not only for the Gettysburg Address, but for the second inaugural address, which in many ways might be his greatest work. But he never reminded people of how tough he had it. He never posed himself as a victim. He simply got on with it, and he saved the nation. He saved the republic. He initiated the emancipation of the slaves. We can never have a greater president than Abraham Lincoln. It's just impossible. Today we are whizzes with social media, but we no longer read books. We tweet, but write nothing. Self-aggrandizement and narcissistic ambition has replaced public service and sacrifice. There is no leadership. There is no unity. There is no vision. Instead, there is fear, division, and blindness. As the book of Proverbs reminds us, without vision, the people perish. Columnist and author David Brooks writes after 9/11, he writes that, and I'm paraphrasing him here, that the American dream died after 9/11, and it was replaced by fear, anxiety, suspicion, and confusion. And everybody got in a really bad mood. Our future is, are you really depressed yet? Our future, that's where baseball will come in, lift you right up. Because it ain't over till it's over, as Yogi Berra. The great poetry of baseball, great poet of baseball reminds us. Our future is no longer bright for a traditionally future-oriented people, who, in the words of our national poet, Walt Whitman, take to the open road. Or Mark Twain concludes Adventures of Huckleberry Finn with this line, "But I reckon I got a light out for the territory ahead of the rest, because Aunt Sally, she's going to adopt me and civilize me, and I can't stand it. I've been there before." We have become blind to the future, proclaimed as a city upon a hill. Thus we look to the past, we look to the founding fathers, and we look to our origins, our collective origins, to find direction, to begin again, as we begin again in spring after winter's death, bringing new life out of the dead land, to regain the vision that once guided and lit our way through a darkened wood in the middle of life. Thank you for taking, if that happens again, could you do it again? Thank you. America has lost its way. That's what David Brooks was getting at in his post 9/11 commentary. America has lost its way. We find ourselves once more in the middle of life in a darkened wood. If any of you have read Dante, you know that line. We find ourselves in the middle of life in a darkened wood. Where is our wise poet Virgil to lead us through this darkness? To whom may we ask our questions? We must find our path through the darkened wood and begin again, as we always have during times of crisis. If we can only go back to a certain starting place, when would that be? 1776? 1863? 1947, when Jackie Robinson played first base in Ebbets Field for the Brooklyn Dodgers, perhaps. So we beat on, F. Scott Fitzgerald writes, boats against the current, borne back ceaselessly into the past. This has happened before. It will happen again. The reality of America never equals or attains the purity, the spirit of America. John Winthrop's City Upon a Hill, but it does offer the land, or the field, or the park, that vast expanse of time and space that make up this republic from sea to shining sea, in which we continue to move closer to that dream, what Lincoln calls the last best hope of Earth. And therein rests the spirit and the reality of baseball as a deep force in a revelation of America and her spiritual quest. Dark and troubled times, through a dark and tangled wood, as a force of atonement, redemption, and goodness, baseball becomes the center of that American experience, the center to which we return. The American experience began in a dark and unforgiving wilderness that had to be conquered, tamed, and refined into settlements and farmlands, eventually towns and cities, businesses and factories. This theme of going into the wilderness is the dominant theme of our American civilization and our American literature. It represents our natural and pastoral origins as a people. Those who came here saw the land as a new world garden, or even a new Eden, a return to the innocence and grace of man before his inevitable fall and exile, a return to a paradise in which we begin again. The very design and environment of the space in which baseball is played represents this new world garden. In all historical likelihood, baseball originated not as a farm boy's game, but rather in the cities. What was played in the back streets and the lanes of cities eventually was played on town commons or city parks or cow pastures, areas of green and growing nature, carved out of the cities, carved out of the wilderness, to create the natural ease of the countryside. Pastoral places of refuge by which to escape for a few hours the noise, the crowdedness of the city. Think about it. A field is carved out of the wilderness. A park is built in the middle of the city. And a yard. A yard is the grass, the trees, and the gardens that circle and surround the house. Baseball is not played so much in stadiums or arenas, but in places with such bucolic titles as the Polo Grounds, Ebbets Field, Camden Yard, and Fenway Park. This is a man's necessary return to nature, to innocence, to play a boy's game, to complete with the cap and the knickers, some sort of a nickname. A nickname like Rube, or Dizzy, or Daffy, or Shoeless Joe, or the Babe, or Satchel, or the Yankee Clipper, or Cool Papa Bell. And begin again. And just as with nature, baseball does not follow the limitations of human-induced time. There is no clock in baseball. No two-minute warning, or no overtime. We don't have the artificial shootout or the ghastly sudden death. The game could go on forever, like heaven. And we who love baseball truly hope each game never ends. Unlike other sports that are linear, baseball is circular in its journey around the bases. Baseball is limited only by forces of nature, the weather, the oncoming darkness of night, or a slow and natural death found in the end of the extra innings. Never the shock of sudden death or the artificiality of the shootout. What are they going to have, a home run derby to end the game? God, I hope not. Baseball follows the rhythms of nature, the rhythms that earlier Americans, not that long ago, found great contentment and even happiness in following. The death slow frozenness of winter being overcome by spring with its returning life, its resurrection, like Dante, a journey from darkness to light, an all too wintry spring, transforming itself into the varied blooms and colors of late spring, and finally being set loose by summer's complete abundance of freedom, the endless march of days and magical lingering nights of summer, summer nights with baseball on the radio, the great radio game, the perfect way to follow a baseball game. You know, with people like Ned Martin and Jim Woods and Ken Coleman, you know, Ernie Hartwell, Bai Sang, you know, Red Bobber, right? Mel Allen, you know, poets of baseball. Look, those are broadcasters who never really played baseball, except as boys. They served in the military. Most of them went to college. They were English majors. They were going to be journalists. Now we've got the already overpaid baseball veterans getting gigs as color men on the broadcasting. And all these English majors and all these journalism majors, they're not getting the jobs anymore. And all we get on the ball games now, and I found it listening to the Sox the last two nights, even on the radio, all we get is analysis of pitching location. And we don't get the narrative. We don't get the story. You don't have Ned Martin. If Ned Martin was broadcasting the end of the opening day game, you know, where Kimbrel almost blew it, that guy's a heart attack, I'll tell you. You know, the tying runs were on base. You know, a home run is going to win it, you know, or something like that. And then there's a lovely pop-up and, you know, the breath goes out of everybody. If Ned Martin was announcing that, you know what he'd say at the end of that game? We had them all in. You know what he'd say to Leon's home run last night? Mercy. He doesn't have the big home run call. He just go, mercy. And that was, you knew, you felt at home listening to Ned Martin and Jim Woods and Ken Coleman and Kirk Gowdy, let's not forget him either. These were pros. They knew the language. They didn't just give you baseball jargon, you know, things like that. But anyway, the radio game is the one that I like to go to more times than not. And eventually, in the long season, welcoming the cool relief of early autumn, and later its long-awaited harvest, the World Series. Again, it is Proverbs that reminds us, we will reap what we sow. This is the creation and the divine will. This is the prophecy and wisdom. This is baseball and the American journey. Every great civilization has its momentous starting point, some sort of a creation myth. Thank you. Where is the American starting point? Our Big Bang, where is our Garden of Eden? When did America begin? The religious separatist, those pilgrims arriving in Plymouth? Was it when the Minutemen were firing their muskets at Lexington and later, more effectively, at Concord? Was it the thunder and lightning bolt decision in Philadelphia in the early hot summer of 1776? Lincoln delivering his great American sermon in the burial ground
at Gettysburg, the immigrant family arriving at last on America's shores. When did America begin? When does it continue to begin? That's what I think America is. It's always beginning again, beginning again. Baseball also has its own creation myth, told for so often that it's been taken as fact. Here's the myth. In the 1830s, in the pastoral village of Cooperstown in upstate New York, on a beautiful spring morning, alongside, a river or perhaps a lake, baseball originated. That's the myth. That's the story. And that baseball was invented by a citizen of Cooperstown, Abner Doubleday. Doubleday was a Civil War general who had fought at Gettysburg, a battle worthy of epic poetry, in that righteous war to save the Union and free the slaves. So he was considered a bona fide American hero, the perfect figure to invent this most American of American games. But get this, Doubleday never even played baseball. In fact, he was a student at West Point when this game was supposedly played in the 1830s. None of this ever happened. There was no bucolic game alongside a lake in Cooperstown, and Abner Doubleday did not invent baseball. But it's a beautiful myth. It's a myth, and it embraces so many American images and feelings and ideas that we want to believe it. And there's nothing wrong with believing it, but it's not the history of it. None of this ever happened.
Excuse me, sir, I have another engagement.
You got it. Thank you for coming. None of this ever happened, but the mythology does illustrate a truth, as all mythology does. A truth of yearning to begin again in some beautiful, wild, but tamed and safe place, a park or a garden, in a village named after the family of our first great American novelist, he of Leatherstocking fame, the creator of Natty Bumppo and the Last of the Mohegans fame. That writer was James Fenimore Cooper of Cooperstown. Another more likely story, more realistic, is this one. That the first organized baseball game was played in Hoboken, New Jersey, in a park called the Elysian Fields on the Hudson River, a reference to the mythic abode of heroes, Elysian Fields, after their exploits and after their suffering and after their glorious deaths, as seen in Greek mythology. Somewhere around 1845, Alexander Cartwright probably laid out what become the basic rules, measurements, and dimensions of baseball. Cartwright established the 9 position players. I always wonder why he chose 9. Why not 10? Well, there's a lot of meaning in numbers that I may get to. Why not 10? You know, you can count them on your fingers, right? 9 position players, the distances between bases, and 3 strikes per batter. Completely different game if it's 4 strikes per batter, or if it's 2 strikes per batter, or if a foul ball on the 3rd strike counts as strike 3. Completely different game, different stats. 3 strikes per batter, transforming a playground or a sandlot game, Cartwright did, into a more challenging and structured organized game. It's got rules. Got measurements, dimensions. More than anyone, Cartwright created the design of baseball. Cartwright is perhaps the Jefferson, the Madison, the Washington of baseball. However, like America, baseball is based more on an idea and a vision rather than a singular event or one person who created it. Baseball, like emerged out of the mist, out of the vision, and just became and got refined as it went on. You know, but we can't pinpoint the inventor of baseball. It just, you can't do it.
And the closest we come is to this guy, Cartwright, you know, who is given credit for a lot of the early rules, like three strikes and nine innings and the measurements between the bases. The boundaries and the rules of the game are the most important part of baseball in terms of its foundations and continuity. Some things just haven't changed at all. Three strikes and three outs. Three times three, nine innings, where each team takes one half in the field with their gloves, and one half is at bat, taking their licks, right? The pitcher's mound is a circle in which the pitcher operates. In the middle of this circle, you've got this rectangular slab of rubber, the pitching rubber, upon which the pitcher must place the toe of one shoe, as opposed to just having it in the dirt where it could move around, it's on something sturdy, as he winds up to throw the ball and begin the action. And in the very early days of baseball, the early 1870s, and even before, the sole purpose of the pitcher was to simply pitch the ball in play. That's all. Put the ball in play. Put it up, and they threw underhand for a long time. Put the ball in play. It wasn't to strike people out or to throw a curve or anything. It was just to put, somebody had to put the ball in play. So you had this guy out there on the pitcher's mound who did it. And it came in slow and you'd whack it. That's all it was. And then, you know, human nature, perhaps especially American human nature, is highly competitive. So after a while, you think that pitcher got a little tired of just being the guy who put the ball in play. And he threw it a little bit harder. And he threw it maybe from the side, you know? And maybe he put a little spin on the ball, or a little spit on the ball, because he wanted to beat the batter, not just put it up there for him. We don't know. We don't know how that came about, but it did. It's obvious, isn't it, watching that Chris Sales last night, that he's not just putting the ball up and play, right? I don't think that's in his nature. Let me see here. Yes, everything. Here we go. The pitcher's rubber is 60.6 multiples of 3 feet from home plate. Then you start thinking, why is home plate called home plate? Why isn't, I've got some students in my class, and you know, they're some of my best students as far as writers go, they're female. They're my best students in this class, but they don't all know that much about baseball, but they're studying it. And one of them the other day referred to home plate as, what she called it? She called it fourth base. Why not third base, you know? Mathematically, that would be it. I've had others call it home base, but it's not a base, it's a plate, and it's shaped differently. It's got different shape. Who the heck thought of that? You know, we don't know. Has that moved yet? Okay, last time I turned, it was him. You know, the good old Judge Landis, who brought law and order into baseball, and he's the one who kicked out those cheaters on the Black Sox, including poor Joe Jackson and talented Eddie Cicotti. You know, he threw them out. You know, they got by. Illinois said that the state of Illinois acquitted them for throwing the World Series. You know, so they thought they were okay, and they played another season. And then baseball got smart and got its first commissioner, somebody who wasn't part of the baseball establishment, and that's Judge Kennesaw Mountain Landis. Tough judge, right, as far as sentences go, and he threw them out. And they never came back. And that was followed again in 1989 when another courageous and very articulate and literary commissioner, A. Bartlett Giamatti, had to do the same thing with Pete Rose. It doesn't matter how important the player is. If he breaks the rules of gambling on baseball or using performance-enhancing drugs, they can be thrown out of baseball. And Pete Rose is out. He's out. He's out for as long as we can foresee. Great ball player, as was Shoeless Joe and Eddie Cicotti and some of the others. You know, Hall of Fame caliber. But they're not in it. They're not in the hall. All right, let's go a little. I think that's Lou Gehrig, isn't it? Okay, let me go a little. The distance from each base to the next one is 90 feet. Everything is built upon the mystical number 3. A beginning, middle, and end. 1, 2, 3. A beginning, middle, and end. A holy trinity, sanctity, holding the game to its spiritual vision. Until the introduction of the designated hitter in the American League, only in 1973, a bad change in my opinion, in order to bat, one had to also play in the field. It was only fair. Everybody wants to bat, but you know, to pay your dues, to get up to bat, you've got to go out there with your glove and do the best you can, like Frank Howard did in left field, right? Not a very pretty fielder, but boy, could he hit home runs. So the manager, Gil Hodges at the time, managing the 1967 Washington Senators, man of big hands, Gil Hodges. I got his autograph, so I saw how big they were. You know, he had to find a way to get Howard in the lineup. So he put him in the outfield wherever he could do the least danger, or he'd plant him on first base and say, just don't move, just stay next to the base, you know? And that's a beautiful part of the game, that a man can be very, very good, very talented in one aspect, like hitting, you know, hitting for power or hitting for average, but maybe he's not a good fielder, you know? And so you see that they're human. You see that even the greatest of the ball players have flaws. Ted Williams, at best, from what I've read about him, was an average, at best, left fielder. They say that he didn't really care too much about fielding. They say that sometimes he'd be taking imaginary swings, kind of like Manny Ramirez, in left field, because he's just waiting to get up to bat. He's lucky he had Dominic DiMaggio playing center to get some of those balls in the gap for part of the career anyway. But anyway, the parameter and the area of every infield in every ballpark is the same. There's no variation. However, due in part to the unpredictable configuration of city streets and businesses and establishments on those streets, in baseball's pioneer days when the ballparks were built in downtown locations, Kenmore Square, right? The design and the distance of the outfield varies in each park. Note the quirky lack of symmetry and varied dimensions in Fenway Park, for instance. That triangle, it's crazy. The wall, you know? All of that, what would have been a home run in Yankee Stadium, is a long single, if Ortiz bothers to run it out, off the left field wall at Fenway. And what would have been a towering pop-up in Yankee Stadium's left field is a game-winning 3-run homer in Fenway Park in early October of 1978 off Mike Torres.
Bucky Dent.
Bucky friggin' Dent would have been a pop-out. Any other, what do they say? The wall giveth and the wall taketh away, right? But then it's got that extraordinary deep right field. You know, that's where Williams had to put him. Although he put a few there too, but mostly dead pole hitter. And thus the first real shift that, who put it on? The Cleveland guy. Lou Boudreau. Player manager established the Ted Williams shift. And now you have shifts for anybody. It's become almost a monstrosity, you know. It had its place with Williams. I guess it had its place with Ortiz, you know. But now they're putting the shift on, you know, average ball players. And very few of them think to bunt down, you know, the unpatrolled line. Ortiz did a few of them the last few years, and those were kind of funny. In addition to the rules and the regulations of baseball, there's also the impartial and judicial team of umpires. There are 4 of these men, a very material number 4. I mentioned that number 3 is spiritual and visionary. The number 4 tends to be more pragmatic and structured and material. The number 4
perhaps even representing, here we go, the four directions of the compass, right? The four sides of a square, the four seasons of the year. They are traditionally, these umpires, sometimes some of my female students, and they're doing very well, sometimes they refer to the umpires as the referees, you know? I gotta correct them on that. they are traditionally dressed in black, the symbolic color of clergy, undertakers, and judges. Unlike the ball players dressed in their late 19th century fashion, still today, of little boys in knickers and caps. I'm glad to see that some of the Red Sox are pulling the pants up below the knee now. I like the look. Maybe it's because Ortiz, who you call Big Poppy. Maybe it's because he's left and they're no longer on the influence of, you know, emulating him with their pants going down over the heels of their feet. But I noticed a number of them last night that they look sharp. I mean, they are the Red Sox. Shouldn't we be able to see the Red Sox? And they're so red, aren't they? I'm losing you there. I want to be able to see everybody. Here we go. Okay, I think that's Mickey Mantle, greatest switch hitter of all time. Right? Let me get back to the umpires. So you've got the ball players are still in the fashion of little boys in knickers and caps. The umpires are dressed in formal suits, complete with ties. Now, some of this goes back a few decades. White shirts and polished, they have a dress code, polished black shoes. They are dressed as grown-up, middle-aged men, even if they're young. They look like grown-up, middle-aged men. They look like my father when he'd come home from his work at the insurance office, you know? Unlike the players on both teams, the umpires never leave their position on the field. They're always there, right? Except through injury, illness, or death. There have been some deaths, heart attacks. They never rest in the dugout. Imagine how extremely cold or hot days these days they would, but generally they don't. Thus, the law, they represent the law. The law is a fixed standard in America. It never rests or takes a break. The umpire, or the voice of the law, or the authoritarian father at the dinner table never compromises, you know? A runner can never be half safe in a pitch is either ball or strike. They don't take the pitch over. It's either a ball, even if the umpire gets it wrong, like the guy last night did for both sides. They live with it. That's it. They'll try better next time. A pitch is either a ball or a strike. It can't be both. There is no compromise. There is no negotiating or plea bargaining in baseball's system of law. Popular opinion, though uproarious and colorful, doesn't change a thing. And well, it should not. The umpire's ruling must forever stand, whether he is wrong or not, which is why I don't like the replay. It's not baseball. It's not baseball. It's football, perhaps. It takes up too much time. They did one last night on a Boston base runner, and it was very much a tie. You could tell. It was a tie. I think it was Cliff Young who did it. And Jerry Remy said, well, we used to say tie goes to the runner, but then Remy laughed and he said, we know that's not true. That's just the way you do it in Sandlot. So it was close, so the umpire made the best call he could, out. And Farrell pled the case. And so they sent back to New York, and they only have something like 30 seconds now to do it. And it came back, and the umpires take their headgear off, you know, and all the Fenway fans, because they're Fenway fans, they all boo. You know, when it's that close, the manager is supposed to simply eat it. It's only supposed to be when it's something, you know, really egregious or outrageous, where the umpire really missed it by a mile. But these managers are just doing it all the time, and it interferes, my view, It interferes with the flow and the rhythm that is baseball. That's the way baseball goes, like that. I got a whole mile length list of things that bother me about baseball today. But I won't get into all of them right now. Here it is. Yep. The umpire's ruling must forever stand, whether he's wrong or not. A call is not supposed to be changed, although now with the new technology and the replay, this is yet another diminishment in the role of authority, just as the authority of the policeman has changed in our society, just as the authority of the father in today's household is fading. Where will this all lead? However, one of the most colorful sideshows in a baseball game is the field manager arguing to no avail against a call made by the umpire. I think of Don Zimmer. I think of Terry Francona, God bless him. I think of Dick Williams. Dick Williams in 67 and 68, part of 70 with Boston. He's in your face. I think of Earl Weaver, don't you think of Earl Weaver? Going at it face to face. I think of Yaz arguing over a call third strike. And you know what he does? Gets down on his hands and knees and he covers home plate with dirt. And then he kicks dirt on the umpire's shoes that are so shiny. And then he gets tossed out of the game and he doesn't care. And the camera goes into the tunnel where Yaz has retreated and he's doing what he always did. He's smoking a cigarette. He's always smoking a cigarette in the tunnel. It's just wonderful. The colorful aspects of the game that I think have changed. I think the ball players have become too sophisticated. They're too well educated. They all go to college these days. They know too much. You know, and they've got the PR department working with them all the time on the proper way to conduct an interview after the game, and they say nothing. They say nothing. They have a script. It's just, give me these colorful characters that have always populated these baseball teams. Eventually the manager or the player is simply thrown out of the game, and it's so much fun. And perhaps he's fined or suspended for a future game. Kill the ump, angry fans used to holler. I wonder what would happen at Fenway if you had some, you know, rowdy looking guy jump up and say, kill the umpire, kill the security. They would think, because of fear and anxiety, he could mean it, you know, because of the world we live in, but come on. Or saying, you know, you're as blind as my grandmother. And the grandmother's understood that. Or your mother wears army boots. You know? All these, you know, they used to take all that razz. And they just, you know, like a good cop, they endure it. They have self-discipline. They're not supposed to get emotionally involved in the situation. You know, whether you're a cop or a judge or an undertaker, right? Or father, in some cases, or an umpire. The umpire, like the all-governing father, never falters or has his feelings hurt. The umpire remains cold and impersonal, never taking the insults from the populace personally. Also, the umpire, like the law, is physically untouchable. There is no greater sign of savagery in a baseball game than touching the umpire. Whether on purpose or by accident, the bumping of the chest, you know, things like that. The umpire is the upholder of the Constitution, the Supreme Court justice. He must not bend to the popular opinions or views of time. And we think of our Supreme Court justice hearings going on right now. We are a people who live by a system of law. With absolute freedom, there is only chaos. Jefferson and the founders, they knew this. They were students of the age of reason. Law's intent, whether it is through the Ten Commandments or the United States Constitution, is to make us less animal and more civilized, to lead us away from the primal swamp and closer to reason and enlightenment and closer to God, to become more like Thoreau and less like the Facebook nation. The baseball field and the game itself sacrifices boundaries culture and the law, sanctifies boundaries, culture, and the law. Without respect for boundaries and culture and law, a nation declines and reverts to chaos and barbarism, the opposite of order and civilization. It happened with ancient Rome, the first model of the great republic. In one of his many writings on the subject, A. Bartlett Giamatti, perhaps the most noble and courageous and short-lived commissioner of baseball that we've ever had, he says this about baseball in one of the many really lovely books that this scholar of the humanities from Yale, you know, he'd been a professor at Yale, he'd been president of Yale, he was a real scholar, but he was an everyman scholar. He was a regular guy. He was known to wear his Red Sox baseball cap, worn and tattered around the campus of Yale. You know, and that was a time where people didn't buy all the franchise up at Fenway Park and everybody has a baseball cap. You know, he was a remarkable man. And of course, in being an academic, he believed in standards. And he believed that, you know, when students are taking a test, that they're not cheating on the test. And so that's the kind of a man that you would want as the steward of the game. He did get chosen to be the president of the National League, but he liked the American League. He liked the Red Sox. So he had to sort of grin and bear it in 1986, Game 6 World Series, when Bob Stanley and Rich Gedman blew it. You thought I was going to say when the ball went through Buckner's legs, didn't you? Give Billy Buckner a break here. That was only Game 6. And maybe the manager should have taken him out because he was taped up to his groin, you know, with his leg problems. We all blame Billy Buckner, the GOAT. Billy Buckner was a fine ball player. He played in four decades, the very end of the 60s and the very beginning of the 90s. So I would put the blame more on the manager or maybe the steamer, maybe Bob Stanley, or maybe it was Rich Gedman who couldn't hold the ball. I don't know. Or maybe it was Clemens who gave up some runs earlier on in the game. But it's so easy to find the scapegoat, the sacrificial victim, to throw to the wolves, to feed to the gods, to atone for the sin of losing that World Series. Well, you know, Giamatti had to put on a brave face and be happy that the National League Mets won. But boy, oh boy, he was hoping the Red Sox would win that one, you know? He was really a remarkable man. And yes, the actor Paul Giamatti is his son. But this, I'm going to quote a portion of a page or two from one of his books in which he talks about this same idea, a very similar idea to what I have here. And he has been an influence on me in terms of his ideas. But this is what he says about baseball and this idea of going home. There's something friendly about that sound, isn't it? There's something relaxing about going home. It's different than penetrating enemy territory and scoring in the end zone. If you want to have a few laughs later, go on YouTube. Look up George Carlin. George Carlin's take on baseball and football. And don't worry, he doesn't swear in that one. The other ones he does. But it's beautiful, the differences between baseball and football in a comical way. Well, here's what Bart Giamatti wrote about baseball. In America, the cluster of associations around the word home and its compounds is perhaps most poignant because of the extraordinary mobility of the American people. From the beginning, we have been a nation constantly moving. The concept of home has a particular resonance for a nation of immigrants, all of whom left one home to seek another. The idea of a homestead establishes a frontier. The new home beyond the home one left back in the East. Everyone has a hometown back there, at least back in time, where stability, or at least its image, remains alive. Stability,
origins, a sense of oneness, the first clearing in the woods. To go home may be impossible, but it is often a driving necessity, or at least a compelling dream. As the heroes of romance, beginning with Odysseus, I teach the Odyssey oftentimes in my higher level literature classes, I'm teaching it right now. Beginning with Odysseus, know the route is full of turnings, wanderings, danger. To attempt to go home is to go the long way around, to stray and separate in the hope of finding completeness in reunion. Freedom is reintegration with those left behind. Giamatti goes on to say, in baseball, the journey begins at home, just like America, negotiates the twists and turns at first base, and often flounders far out on the edges of the ordered world or the frontier at rocky second base, the farthest point from home, second base. Whoever remains out there is said to die on base. Home is finally beyond reach in a hostile world full of quirks and tricks and hostile folk. There are no dragons in baseball, only shortstops. But they can emerge from nowhere to cut one down. And when it is given one to round third, a long journey seemingly over, the end is in sight. And then the hunger for home, the drive to rejoin one's earlier self and one's fellows is oppressing, growing, screaming in the blood. Often the effort to return home fails. The hunger is unsatisfied as the catcher bars fulfillment, as the umpire father is too strong in his denial, as the impossibility of going home again is reenacted. And what is often baseball's most violent physical confrontation. You know, the runner going into the catcher, right? Swift, savage, down in the dirt, nothing availing. Or if the attempt, long in planning and execution, works, then the reunion and all it means is total. The runner is a returned hero, and the teammates are for an instant all true family. Until the attempt is tried again. A home run is the definitive kill. The overcoming of obstacle at one stroke, the gratification instantaneous in knowing one has earned a risk-free journey out, around, and back. A journey to be taken at a leisurely pace, but not too leisurely, David Ortiz. So as to savor the freedom, the magical invulnerability from denial or delay. If baseball is a romance epic, it is finally told by the audience. Baseball is the romance epic of homecoming that America sings to itself. End of quote. Giamatti, president of Classics and former president of Yale, president of the National League, Nobel Commissioner of Baseball, saw baseball as significant as any of the other institutions of American life, including the Constitution and Congress and the executive branch and the legal branch. And when those who saw that they could financially and egotistically benefit by tarnishing the integrity of the game, the integrity of this national institution by bending and breaking the sacred rules of the game, Giamatti did not hesitate to investigate, to prosecute, and to punish the lawbreakers, no matter how popular or talented in the game they might be. So in August of 1989, after a grueling legal case, A. Bartlett Giamatti, Commissioner of Baseball, steward of the game, banned Pete Rose, the the all-time base hit leader with 4,256 base hits. More base hits than Ty Cobb, more base hits than Ted Williams or Willie Mays, banned him from baseball, and also its hallowed Hall of Fame for life for betting on baseball. Even though Rose claimed that he bet on his teams to win, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. Even if you're betting on your team to win, you might be putting some of your players at risk. You might keep a pitcher in too long. You might put a guy up to bat who maybe, you know, has a bad leg or something like that, but you know that with one swat, he can hit the home run. The thing is, it's against the laws of baseball to bet on a game, whether you're betting on your team to win or lose. And also with gambling, well, there's associations oftentimes with bad people, you know? You and me, we can put a little money on a game between ourselves, but if you play on a team, you can't. There's mobsters, oftentimes these days, and also back in the 20s and 19-teens, gamblers were associated with rum runners during Prohibition. Guys like Al Capone and, you know, other mobsters. They were associated with heroin pushers. Yeah, back in the 20s and 19-teens, oftentimes the rum runners were also involved in pushing drugs. And that's the case today, too. And it was found out that Rose had been hanging around with a lot of heroin addicts and heroin dealers in New Bedford and Fairhaven. So, you know, it's not good. It's not good with that. So, you know, a lot of people still say, yeah, but come on, what he did on the field is what's important. And there were worse guys than him. You know, Ty Cobb was a pretty miserable guy, you know. But even that might have been exaggerated from a new book that came out about Cobb. But, you know, Rose broke the laws of baseball and perhaps the law of the land, too, in doing this. It was not a popular decision. It's Pete Rose. I love watching Pete Rose. Charlie Hustle, they call him. That guy played the game hard. You know, there was no quit with that guy. And it wasn't merely a lot of natural ability. You know, he just threw himself into the game. He's that kind of a personality. But he's a real tragic figure because that sort of arrogance that worked in the game, thinking he was better than everybody, it brings him down in the end. It's his tragic flaw. Back to just the end of the last few paragraphs of this here. Pete Rose can never enter baseball's sacred temple. We can only hope that the present and future commissioners have the courage and leadership to uphold this hard ruling over the ever-changing winds of popular opinion. Baseball is a game that honors failure and human aspirations. The heroes of the game, Ty Cobb, Hank Aaron, Roberto Clemente, fail 7 out of each 10 at-bats. You know, if you play, I don't know, 10 years and you get enough at-bats, right, and you hit 300 or better, you got a good chance of making the Hall of Fame. But you fail 7 out of 10, unless you're Ted Williams in 1941. He only failed 6 out of 10 times when he hit, what for an average?
401.
It's never been done. Never been done since, and I would say it's never going to be done again. Because I don't think ball players play enough games. They're always rested, you know, or they're out like all the Red Sox are now with the flu. You know, they don't play enough games. You're not going to have 300 game winners either, because they don't pitch enough innings. How many games did Spahn win?
361.
All right, 361, but he lost 245. In order to win that many, but also lose that many, you've got to go deep into the game. At some point, go on baseballreference.com and see how many complete games he had each season. It's going to be over 20, you know, and how many he had for a career. Because if you've got guys that only go 5 or 6 innings and they get a standing ovation when they come off the mound, you know, they're often not in the game when the game is won or lost. So it's tough to even have a 20-game winner anymore. or have somebody who pitches over 200 innings, unless, you know, you're a horse like a Lester or somebody like that, or Sales, you know, a lot of them. Buckholz never got to 200, Buckholz, right? He never got to 200 because he was so fragile with his arm, his body, and probably a little bit up here. It was a little bit of a head case, Clay Buckholz, a little neurotic, you know. Okay. Baseball is a game, I mentioned that, about failure. Yet these guys who hit 300 or above, they often enter the shrine, Baseball Hall of Fame. And where else is it? Cooperstown, New York. That too is American failure. Our heroes are not carved out of marble or steel. They too, all of them, are very flawed human beings, although I haven't found any flaws in Mr. Abraham Lincoln. And everybody's trying to find something that can bring them down to our level, but you know, I haven't. You find them in Jefferson, you find them in Washington, you find them all over. But I haven't found it in Lincoln. He's too good to be true. He's just simply too good to be true. But that too is America. To have someone like that who, I guess he's the closest thing to a Greek god that we could ever have. He wouldn't have seen that. Because what did he have that other leaders don't? Humility. Humility, but a firm sense that he was right in terms of that tragic but necessary war. Our heroes are very flawed human beings who fail often, yet achieve great things. If at first you don't succeed, try again. And fail again. And try again. Baseball, like America, has known failure and loss. Yet the hope for something better always endures. Where Yogi Berra can say it ain't over till it's over. Where Brooklyn fans could say about their beloved Dodgers, them bums, wait till next year. That originated in Brooklyn, not Kenmore Square. In Brooklyn, wait till next year. I hear Abraham Lincoln saying in his address to Congress in December 1862, as he saw the Union breaking apart in the first year and a half of the Civil War, just days before the Union catastrophe on Mary's Heights, Fredericksburg, Virginia. Lincoln could still say to Congress, America is the last best hope of this earth. And baseball, as long as America is indeed America, an exceptional nation, a nation with a just and humane interest for this world, and not just any other nation. Baseball will always be America's game. Thank you.
That will just about do it for this edition of HCAM News. Don't forget, you can stay up to date with everything Hopkinton by checking out our website, hcam.tv, as well as our Twitter and Facebook page. Right now on our website, hcam.tv, you can view information about many terrific community events coming up in the very near future, as well as more from the Legacy Farms North Road opening. If you have a Hopkinton-related video, photo, or story idea, I want to hear from you. Email me at news@hcam.tv. With your help, we'll cover even more of our community. For everyone here at HCAM, I'm Tom Nappy. Take care, and as always, thanks for watching HCAM.